Well, just look at that Lok Sabha. That's the future Lok Sabha 2014. Durab, an amazing, would you call this a landslide?
It is, because if you knock off 1984, I mean, it's much, much bigger than anything else, you know, we've seen for the last 30 years, exactly 30 years.
Just look at the colour of Parliament. Well over half is the BJP and its allies. Yeah.
Since
339.
That's since 1984, we don't have a leader of the opposition.
Right, and a single party forming a majority on its own.
Yeah.
And a landslide in many, many states. Landslide meaning every seat.
That's right. I think five to six states, the Congress either zero seat or one seat.
What a day. What a day it's been. It's been a remarkable day. The people of India have not spoken. They have yelled out their preference, and it's been Narendra Modi. And they've also yelled their disapproval. The Congress has been decimated. It probably will fall below the 54 required to be an official opposition party. So the next parliament may not have an official opposition party or an opposition leader. Now, we've seen a lot about seats and changes in seats, but what about the All India vote figure? That's always been very critical, because many parties have got majorities with 35, 33, 34% of the vote, because the opposition has been split. This is the final vote figures. Of course, they may change by a few percentage points here and there. BJP and its allies, 39%. That's amazing, Dora.
It's an enormous increase from last time, more than 10% increase from last time in one election to go for.
No, but what I'm shocked is that your exit poll said 37.4%. I mean, come on. Oh, sorry. Plus or minus 2%. Sorry. And Congress, 24%, and others, 36%. And others tended to hold on. Most regional parties, except in Uttar Pradesh, tended to hold on to their vote. Biju Patnaik, Mamata Banerjee, here are the swings. Look at that. Plus 13% for the BJP. That is a remarkable swing by any standards. Yeah, 13%.
I don't think we've seen that except in very exceptional years.
And the Congress from 33 down to 24, a negative swing of 9%. And others, minus 4, mainly in Uttar Pradesh, where the Samajwadi Party and the BSP in particular got badly, badly mauled. Now, Arun, if you can just give us this in perspective, the spectacular change in votes, the swing of 13, most unusual.
Yes. Absolutely.
What is the strategy behind this?
Well, I would not know, but I'm sure that one is starting very early.
Right, right.
And second is that while you may think of Amit Shah as a very sort of traditional type of politician, but actually they have deployed modern management methods. I think that's being underestimated. Everybody is just saying it's advertising or money, but in mobilization, in booth level work, in data analysis, my friend Rajesh Jain, if you just have to see, I mean, Durab would be the person who would...
I met him some time ago.
Yes, and he could tell you for every single voter. He had mapped the electoral data with the census data, with your mobile number, and by 3 o'clock, if you have not voted, they could
SMS.
Right.
SMS
so the use of high technology
and management.
Right.
So I think this modern approach. This is the first time we have seen an election in which there is a modern approach to managing an election.
Right. One more question.
Obama versus Adlai Stevenson. The Congress was in Adlai Stevenson election.
Sir, Adlai Stevenson and Rahul Gandhi.
The technology was the old.
You've been a journalist on the print medium. Now, television is all pervasive. When we went through the tiniest villages of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, poorest homes with meager, no furniture, etc. But they would have 2 to 3 televisions, one for each member of the family. And they all were talking in the same, using the same words. We want to have like Gujarat development. So would you say this was one of the, probably the first big television elections, and the BJP got that early? They understood it.
Yes, they understood it. And also that the critics worked very hard to make Modi a national figure first.
Right.
Everybody, all the time, he's the only issue. You made him the only issue. And then he correctly recognized that this has to be a presidential election, because the great difference is not between the candidate of party X and the candidate of party Y, but between Modi and anybody else who can be put up to rival him. Right. So therefore you must run a presidential campaign. And his critics had helped in that process.
And he is a great orator.
Orator,
so
yes,
they actually played into his hands.
That's a very important point, because you see, Dr. Manmohan Singh doesn't speak. Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, not a great orator. Right. Rahul Gandhi, just learning. Right. And on the other side, Narendra Modi as an orator. So in communication also, I think when people just say it is marketing, branding, money, you are not wanting to believe the strengths of the other right. person.
Right, and the phenomenal energy. I mean,
I tell you, since we've all grown up, I have not seen this kind of energy since Panditji's time. In that time when we were in college, we used to hear about Panditji having this kind of energy. But even in Panditji's case, there was one other thing that Modi has, which I'm not comparing the two, but Modi has exhibited energy and focus.
Right.
In Panditji's case, he was managing Indochina one day and the United Nations the other day. Yes. So focus also.
And that has been his style. He has been focused in Gujarat as well in running the state.
But Prannoy, I think we shouldn't forget that in all of northern India where Hindi is understood, you know, his message went out night after night after night.
Versus on television.
Versus weak messages, someday coming, not coming. Every day hammering the same message in. I think if you keep on hammering the same message.
And effectively.
And you know, if you recall that some people we met in Bihar and UP said that, you know, they didn't want to hear anymore about Gujarat. They knew about it already. Now they want to hear about getting the same Vikas here. So the story was already told.
In fact, as we speak.
But this is one other thing. It is not repeating the same speech.
No.
It is a message with new things.
Right.
I must say, we've heard several of his speeches ourselves over the since Chhattisgarh. And finally, how many different speeches can I have, for God's sake? I mean, I can have five variations. That's it.
But it was the one point. There would be some new phrase, there would be some new expression,
yes.
which
yes.
would then make the headlines, and the media also seems to sort of catch on to that particular.
Right. He knew how to get the attention. Okay, I need to interrupt and just dip into Narendra Modi is speaking. He did give a very forceful victory speech a little earlier. Here he's speaking again in Ahmedabad.
Desh ke अधिकतम मतदाताओं ने डेवलपमेंट के मुद्दे पर वोट दिया है. हमारे देश में ये माना जाता था कि विकास के मुद्दे पर चुनाव नहीं लड़ा जा सकता. हमारे देश में माना जाता था कि चुनाव जीतने के लिए टुकड़े फेंकने पड़ते हैं, चुनाव जीतने के लिए वोट बैंक की राजनीति करनी पड़ती है. भाइयों बहनों, जिनको वो आदत थी वो अपना खेल उन साधनों को लेकर के खेलते रहे. हमने तय किया था हम गुड गवर्नेंस पे, डेवलपमेंट के मुद्दे पर चुनाव लड़ेंगे. बहुतों को सवाल था कि मोदी जी बात पहुंचेगी कि नहीं पहुंचेगी. भाइयों बहनों, पिछले 8 महीने के अविरत पुरुषार्थ के बाद मैं कह सकता हूं हिंदुस्तान का बहुत बड़ा तबका अब तैयार हुआ है जो कहता है हमारी सारी मुसीबतों का उपाय विकास है, डेवलपमेंट है.
That is Narendra Modi back at his best in terms of oratory and his interaction with the crowd. We are also joined now by Manohar Parikar, who's had a very successful election. He's won both his seats. Many congratulations. I've interviewed you when you were a very young lad, and you have developed. I remember your academic background. Congratulations today, a great victory, but you had a tough time with the mines being shut down, revenues being short as a result. How are you going to combat all this now?
We have already combated it.
For the victory. But now the hard work begins.
Model which nation needs to follow. Yes, with 25% revenue short from mining, my today's revenue are 8% plus without mining.
Right, so how will this victory change your the way you run Goa? How will it change everything?
Number one, I think in Goa also, we have snatched for the first time. We had won this seat, South Goa seat earlier, but that was by default.
Right. Arun Shori would like to, I suppose, congratulate you and ask you a question.
Yes. As you know, I'm one of your great admirers. And each time I go to Goa, I hear the best of things for you. And all these people who keep talking about being BJP, being divisive and so on, actually you are the emblem of bringing people together all over the state and getting everyone to work for in bringing Goa to a new direction. But how do you see, apart from your apart from the state's dependence on mining, what are the new areas of development which you think Goa will pioneer in and be an example for the rest of the country?
I think we need to push the tourism in a better way. Goa tourism got a lot of bad flack because of drugs, sex and other such issues. But we are trying to clean it up. So that can be one. And Goa can also sustain certain types of industries and investment. It's a very clean place. Pharma is doing great in Goa. So industrial sector to the liking of people, I think can be a good model for Goa.
Would you consider
education,
also in that, you know, things like Pune near you and others are manufacturing centers. Would you consider being a design center for manufacturing centers so that you have modern people, skilled people, without polluting the polluting consequences of manufacturing? You know, Pune
We are considering that aspect because our investment policy is big. And we can even go for research kind of thing because a lot of people love to come to Goa for working.
Right, we all actually, I think we'll move our NDTV headquarters to Goa. It's the most beautiful place. Why are we stuck here in Delhi?
The problem with doing research in Goa is that everybody will go to sleep.
I'll send you a proposal.
Sir, I'm very interested to hear that you want to make tourism one of your focuses. But one of the new developments, well, not so new, maybe in the last 5-6 years, is Indian tourism is pretty big in Goa. I'll give you a small anecdote. One of the people in the shacks told me, one of the owners, they have to pay the taxi driver some money to bring tourists to their restaurant. So they pay 200 rupees per Russian, 150 rupees per Indian, and only 50 rupees per Englishman. Things have changed. So Indian tourists are also important now in Goa.
Indians spend a lot of money in Goa.
Correct, yes. That's what he said, yeah.
No, not that. Indian tourists spend at least 3 to 4 times some of the foreigners.
That's right, yes. So will you be focusing on Indian tourism
and
as well?
Sometimes they drink like fish. Obviously, Indian tourism has increased manyfold in past 10 years. And the good part of it and bad part of it. But I think Indian tourism also is booming in Goa.
So you'll be focusing not just on overseas tourism, but Indian tourism as well?
No, we are trying to focus on a quality tourism.
Quality, okay.
Backpackers don't add much value.
I see. That's an important point, actually. Right. So we're going to take up your offer, and all of us, including Arun, are going to move to Goa and work out of there. Pretend to work.
Arun already, he already has a house in Goa.
So does Prannoy.
I wish I had.
Ravi Shankar Prasad, are you going to move to Goa? You work too hard. You can't relax in, you should be like us, relax in Goa. Oh, but you don't get litti in Goa, I
forgot. Dr. Roy, I can only tell you that the mining ban which Manohar Parikar, my very good friend for whom I have great regard, talked about, and also the occasion to appear in the Supreme Court on behalf of a lot of workers who suffered because of the ban on mining.
Right.
Fortunately, we succeeded.
But I must say, Derek O'Brien, you do look the type that would love Goa.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And especially a beach party this evening.
Right, exactly. Okay, now enough of this. We get back to the facts, and then in the next half an hour or so, if we can look ahead rather than why and what happened in this election, but what's the agenda ahead? What do you expect to unfold? But one or two interesting factors about this victory and this landslide for the BJP. Let's have a look at some of the major states, the states in the north and the west of India. Just look at the simple figures and you'll understand the landslide in this part of India. The facts are that in the north and west states, that's Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, UP, Delhi and Chhattisgarh, the votes, percentage votes for the BJP and its allies over 50%. Very unusual, Dorab, to get more than 50%.
But you know, most of these are two front fights, direct fights, unlike in other states like UP,
right,
where they've done a phenomenal job but still with 40% of the votes. These right. are two-way fights.
But look at the number of seats also. Yeah, 211 out of 226.
15 seats to the
Congress. Talk about a landslide. It doesn't get bigger than this. It hasn't probably been bigger than this since 77 and 84.
Yeah.
Amazing. So with a mandate like this, Ravi Shankar Prasad, what is the plan ahead? Just name one or two things that are going to happen right away that you want to see happen, that will make a difference to the people of India.
First of all, toning up the economy. I don't think there's a need to talk about 100 days.
Yeah, okay.
Dr. Manmohan Singh said, I will bring the prices down to 100 days.
Okay, 30 days.
100 days, what happened? No. What is important is to set the agenda for 5 years and start working from day one. The first right. thing is to restore the health of economy, manufacturing sector, decision making, non-discriminatory, sound economic policy, sound taxing policy, the kind of enabling atmosphere, so that the entire cycle of economy starts growing and
right.
growing.
Talking the about the economy,
infrastructure sector.
Right. Talking about yes. the economy, Arun Shori, you're an economist by training. Couple of specific things. I understand the broad direction that Ravi Shankar Prasad is talking about, but two or three specific things. For example, when you were in government, the disinvestment policy, which I think was the most important policy India has done on the economic front in many years, it made a big difference down the line. Are we going to see more of that? Any other issues like that?
I don't think so. Mr. Narendra Modi is not inclined towards disinvestment. He would feel much more comfortable in other things. And I'll give you one or two. His forte is implementation.
Right.
And one of the problems has been that it's not the lack of ideas or even of project proposals, but it is just not getting anywhere.
Right.
So
right.
file so is true. Moving from Dorab to Prannoy to me to somebody else. He will get all those secretaries together. Everybody discusses the issue for 7 hours if necessary. Decisions are taken on coal. Everybody goes back, implements it, and 2 weeks later reports that it has been implemented. Right. For that reason, I think he will have a much stronger Prime Minister's office with not just one economic secretary, to take only Ravi Shankar's example of reviving the economy, but with four secretary-level officers, not just joint secretaries to whom secretaries will not listen, four coordinating persons for four things, and then push it that way. That's one.
So implementation, I think execution has been a big, big problem yes. in India for decades, actually.
Yes. And second point, I think, is it is investor confidence in public sector, actual investments, but investor confidence in the private sector, which has collapsed. that requires, you know, just a few announcements, I feel, and also reining in things like the income tax department. I mean, if you see the grounds on which Nokia or Vodafone, Nokia's
or even IBM.
IBM.
I mean, it's just shocking.
No, but if you see the ground on which it has been done.
That the entire IBM operation in India is a sham. It's just outrageous.
Why? They say that you are sending this by telegraphic wires, wires, and VSNL has no wires outside India. Therefore, your exports of 6,000 crores are actually just all sales within India. VSNL collaborates. I mean, the message goes by somebody else's wires to other countries. They say no. In Nokia's case, 25,000 crores they exported mobile things, and foreign exchange has come into India. But the fellow says no, this is interstate sale. It is not sold in India.
Should the income tax department have targets? They should collect what is due to them.
Due to them.
Why
yes,
should they be a target?
Right, right, and pressure just to collect it from anywhere.
Yeah, but anywhere, yeah. And there are several legal. So really, tax administration and other things will have to be.
So tax administration, execution of say infrastructure projects, make sure they're done.
Dialogue with the judiciary on things like environment.
Yeah, can I make a point?
Sorry,
you made the point about Mr. Parerikar about how industry is polluting. Now that manufacturing has got to create most jobs.
Yes.
How will we meet the challenge of manufacturing versus environment? Because all our most of our things that are held up are because of environmental clearances.
So what do we do? I think it's not because of conflict between manufacturing and environment. It is because the environment ministry is just being cussed in many ways.
And sometimes a way to collect revenues.
Revenue, meaning under the table. Yes, a tax that was private taxation.
Private tax.
That was 200 files are found in the minister's house which have been signed and not dispatched to the concerned people. It would never happen under Modi. I think nobody would dare do that.
I think Ravi Shankar Prasad has a point on what you're saying. Ravi Shankar Prasad?
You just talked of disinvestment, Dr. Roy.
Right.
The personal integrity of Mr. Arun Shori is too well known.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Taken in the NDA regime. And how the CBI has sought to hound him based upon motivated PILs, not contesting it properly, the government of India becoming a willing accomplice, officers like Pradeep Bajal have been targeted. You know, when you start doing it, you are causing a long-term damage to the economy of India. That's what I'm trying to highlight.
Right. So that is something which the Modi-led BJP government will not do, will not go after the previous regime and try and find things and harass them.
But there's an important point there.
Right.
I think Ravi's point is really, you first have to have ministers who will take responsibility. Then civil servants will feel secure enough to take decisions.
Right.
But if I may supplement what Ravi was saying with this, the first thing to do is to have a list of things that can be done by each department without legislation.
Executive orders.
Executive orders.
Very right.
Many things can be done today. You want independent directors to be appointed in banks, you don't require a new law. In fact, law in India is a substitute for doing things. Second point, which is very important, to get reforms going, use the concurrent list. So that if a state is progressive, Parikar is progressive, he amends the labor law, then for that state, that amendment should prevail over the central law.
Right.
A single announcement by Mr. Modi will sort of trigger reforms in the states.
Right.
Land acquisition, labor, apprenticeship, all these are held up by central acts.
Yes, then those need major changes. If I bring Derek O'Brien here, Derek O'Brien, your agenda over the next, not 100 days, I'm told not to use the word 100 days, how are you going to work with the center? Is it going to be an important factor in your plan ahead?
Dr. Roy, we've just won a very difficult and a very tough victory here in Bengal.
Right.
We've been campaigning for a long while like everybody else. We've put out our development agenda for the last 3 years, and we were hoping we've communicated that message, so we get a referendum today. We've won a big victory. The last thing on my mind is what we're going to do tomorrow or day after. Please, I'm sure it's a privilege to be on your program because when I was a teenager, we used to watch your programs on election day.
Not teenager.
But I think we're going to savor this evening.
Not teenager. You were in kindergarten when we started.
Okay. May not be. No.
Shocking.
I think we're going to savor this evening. Our members of parliament are meeting, newly elected members of parliament are meeting tomorrow with Mamta Di. So we are having a parliamentary meeting tomorrow, okay. And we'll take all our calls at that meeting tomorrow. This evening, you wanted to send me to Goa for a party, but we'll party in Calcutta. And everyone's from the Trinamool, of course, across Bengal.
I understand.
We are grateful to the people of Bengal for giving us this wonderful opportunity and endorsing our development agenda.
I understand. Thanks. And let me tell you, the parties in Bengal are often much better than the parties in Goa. It's just the surroundings in Goa are better. But I do have to ask you, at a time like this, when you're celebrating, there are lots of very serious charges against you about violence, intimidation, booth capturing, preventing voters, that you're almost doing what the CPM did 20 years ago. In fact, you've taken it to a new level. How do you respond to that?
As I said at the top of your program, it's been a very difficult campaign because not only have we fought the Congress, the BJP, and the CPM, we've had to take on the might of one or two media houses here in Bengal who have been blowing up and overhyping every issue. It's an insult to the people of Bengal. They've come out and voted peacefully. Of course, there have been one or two sporadic incidents, but we've been fighting this very, very David and Goliath kind of battle. So today we feel vindicated because even till last week, there were large media groups here. This is a major concern for us. We feel is the time, one of the new things the new government will do is electoral reform. Because today, the entire media has become corporatized. So small parties like us, we don't have millions of dollars to spend. So we've got to get our message across by running around in the summer heat and doing our meetings. But we'll keep doing that. Because today is a very emotional day because we really know what we were up against.
What about the violence? So, you haven't answered that question. Violence and booth capturing. Even the Election Commission has frowned on you. Why did you have to resort to that? You probably would have done this anyway, wouldn't you have?
I can absolutely tell you right up straight.
Right.
No one resorted to violence or booth capturing. We win elections because of the love of the people of Bengal and nothing else. And that's why the left, in our earlier two elections, they were dead in Bengal. Today they got buried in Bengal, but we want to be gracious in victory.
Please don't use those kind of phrases, dead and buried. When we're talking about violence, those are the wrong choice of words.
No. I did not mean it in that way.
I know.
If I meant it in that way, my apologies.
No, that's fine.
Mean it in that way.
No, I know you didn't. I know you didn't.
I really, since you've asked me this question, I really need to communicate today very honestly. We fought a terrible, you know, last week there's the largest television channel here local were running opinion polls. You all are the experts on opinion polls. You were saying we'll get between 27 and 34. We got 34. There was a large television channel here running a poll which said the left would get 36% and the Trinamool Congress would get 33%. This is very disappointing. It's actually hurtful at times, so there's no use getting angry about it now because at the end of it all we are smiling.
Yeah, exactly.
It's the people who finally decided.
Anyway, thank you very much. But I am going to take you up on one thing. You're going to have your party tonight. You're going to have your meeting tomorrow. We're going to have a chat after that, maybe a week later. And you're going to tell me your exact plans ahead because we need to know what you're going to do for Bengal. But I'll give you 1 week, okay?
Roy, we have done for 3 years in Bengal. You don't have to wait for next week. I will mail that to you tomorrow because the people of Bengal who are living here know what we've done. But I have a lot of respect and regard for you because you're the guru of elections. I will mail that to you tomorrow morning.
God bless you and have a great party tonight and have fun. God bless you. Thank you very much and see you in a week or two's time. Thank you very much. We'll take a short break. When we come back, we look at these amazing, amazing swings in some of the states that have happened this time. And it's mind-boggling. Talk about a landslide. Wait till you see this. That's in a moment from now. So you were just looking at the current parliament, the newly elected, and it's just dominated by saffron. And you can see the Congress in one tiny corner on the far side in the opposition benches. And since they haven't hit 10% of the overall Lok Sabha, they may not be considered an opposition, official opposition party. Look at that, 58 Congress and its allies, but really dominated by the BJD, TMC, AIDMK, and of course the BJP and its allies. Let's have a look at the swings we are talking about. You know, normally you talk about a big swing is about 5%, because that can change a margin of victory of 10%. But look at this. Here's a BJP swing in Uttar Pradesh. 25% they're up in Uttar Pradesh.
From 17% to 42.
I mean, these are kind of swings you really rarely see in history. So this is a historic election, yeah, in many ways. Look at the swing in Rajasthan from an already high position, another 19%.
No, they were quite weak last time, so they've actually shifted.
But still, they've gone way over 50% as a result of this.
Four or five states, they've gone
over 50%. Look at the next state, Bihar, 16% swing. This is Gujarat now, 13% swing in Gujarat from an already high position. All of these are now, except for UP, the others are over 50% vote. Now, just to bring us down to reality, and we looked at that parliament, if we can have another look at it in a different vein, just let's have a look at the type of MPs we are getting this time. Are they young? Are they old? How do they match the age profile of the population of India? Let's have a look at are our MPs younger or older? By young, we're going to talk about under 50?
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. So how young is the Lok Sabha 2014? 25 to 50, 39%. 39%. And older MPs, 61%. Guess what? The average in India is for older MPs over 50. The population in India over 50 is 16% of India. 16% of India, but 61% of Parliament. We need more younger MPs, right? And young, Shekhar, you don't say under 50 is young.
In India, under 50 is juvenile.
And let's have a look at the gender breakup of the elected MPs. How many men and how many women? Is it time now for women's reservation? Looking ahead. This program is about looking at ahead, sorry. Women MPs, just 11% of the next Lok Sabha. And men MPs, 89%. Any chance of this government bringing in women's reservation of 33%?
I would not be the person to know.
No.
Because I am against all reservations of all kinds. Okay. So
We shouldn't call it reservation. We should call it affirmative action.
Could be. But just one point on the looking at the MPs and looking at the results.
Right.
You know, one, you were saying about the clarity of the message that went across. But one of the messages that went across very effectively was, this is an election for prime ministership, it's not for your state assembly election. And the Indian voter really discriminated so well. In Shekhar's columns, we have seen, in your reports, we have seen this. And secondly, the idea that it's not you are not really voting for this MP, you are voting for Modi.
Right.
This was a twin message, and this is the sense in which it was really a presidential election. But even from the BJP's point of view, these two messages were conveyed very effectively.
Right, right. We're now joined by Shashi Tharoor. A young Shashi Tharoor, but the Congress party just lost the youth in this election. How did you not catch the imagination of the young voter in India?
That's a very fair point, and I'm afraid I belong to the wrong side of the equation you just showed on your screen.
No,
because I'm over 50, so I'm in that unrepresentative 16% of the population that has 61% of parliament. You know, the fact is this is a real challenge in our country. We do need to connect better with young people, and we need to bring more young people into parliament, no question about that, and into politics. As far as my own party is concerned, we've lost some of our youngsters. We've lost some of our younger ministers, our brighter lights, to this Modi wave or tsunami or whatever you want to call it. People of the quality of Sachin Pilot, of Melendera, of Jitendra Prasad, of RPN Singh, these are bright young people on the right side of your demographic who actually have lost in some cases to older BJP candidates.
So that's the question.
In some ways, the electorate is making that choice, not just the parties.
Yeah, that's the choice. Your message didn't grab the imagination of the younger voter. What went wrong? And how are you going to change that in the future? We're trying to look ahead.
Well, that's a very
fair
point. I still remember. Yeah, I still remember back in 2009 when I was first elected Prime Minister Manmohan Singh saying to us, the newly elected Congress MPs, you know, we won the overwhelming support of young voters in this election, and we must always respect the impatience of the young. And coming from a then 78-year-old Prime Minister, I thought that was a very profound insight, the impatience of the young. I think we didn't manage somehow to match that impatience. We didn't deliver enough change rapidly enough to match that impatience of the young, and they impatiently turned to somebody who promised to wave a magic wand and do it for them.
So one of the things we're looking ahead, and we were just talking a little earlier before you joined us, about the change in the nature of elections with Arun Shori, how this is now becoming a big media or big television phenomenon, because television has penetrated virtually every home in this country in perhaps more ways than we appreciate. Has the time come where nobody is going to be able to be elected unless they are television friendly? Someone like you, television friendly.
Well, maybe yes and maybe no. I'll tell you, I mean, in my own party, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi is not particularly garrulous on television. She's a fairly reticent person, and she won by a considerable majority in Rai Bareilly.
So is that changing?
Again, I mean,
she has a legacy and a history. Is it changing?
Well, so that's what I'm saying. There are various factors in different places and different times. But as a general proposition, let me agree with you that we do need to be much more communicative, that reticence doesn't pay, that we have to be able to reach out to people, that we have to be visible in their living rooms, as it were, on their television screens, on a day-after-day basis, if we want to win and retain their trust. And that is a general message, I think, that we've already learned, but perhaps learned a bit late. You've seen the Congress party has been much more upfront and much more on TV in the last year or so than it was in previous years. But that last year was probably just not enough. And certainly, Mr. Modi and the BJP ran a far, far better organized, better financed and more lavish media marketing campaign over the years.
So, Arun, you're a great strategist. If you had to tell Shashi Tharoor and the Congress party what they should change, two things, what would you tell them to change?
Well, and Shashi is a much better communicator, but two, three points. One is this phrase that has come up again and again in Congress explanations, that it was the failure of communication. I think this is really the facts of malgovernance. It's just it's sort of papers over them. We must face that reality. If I were in your party, that is very important. Second is the point that Shekhar has been making repeatedly. You cannot run a campaign against your own government and win. Many of the speeches of some of your leaders were really about things that are so wrong and how they are going to improve it. That's for the opposition to do. Third is, Modi's campaign was a campaign about hope. Your campaign was about stoking fear about Modi. And finally, I think the problem is that one of the wonderful things that the last few elections show is that freebies don't work.
Except in Tamil Nadu.
Well, they didn't.
Competitive freebies.
Well, what about, no, look at DMK, gave everything and was wiped out.
But Jayalalitha gave just a bit more.
Well, promised.
I think what is happening is you just got to match it to neutralize it. So
look at Gehlot. Look at Gehlot, what he did not give and promise.
Nobody has given freebies like Gehlot gave. He used up all his oil revenues from Cairn, which his own government has tried to squash.
Yes. And Shekhar, the other point is that it is not freebies people are looking for. People are looking for jobs, for opportunities.
Yes,
which
hope.
Was not conveyed. It's not just, it was not conveyed, it was not created.
So that's a key point, actually. This was looking ahead. This was an election not just about negative of the past government. It was looking ahead, hope for this future government. So that's a lot of pressure. And if I can just bring in Pavan Verma.
We traveled a lot in the countryside. Right. This is a rejection of the politics of saying, come to my school, I'll give you a lousy free meal, but I'll give you no education because my teachers don't come to work. That people of India don't need anymore.
Right.
The people of India
example.
Are not starving. So this is to say, tum bhukhe nange ho, you're bhukha nangas, I'll throw some
I just wanted to bring in Pavan Verma here.
Pavan comes, that it is not, and then it is not just about promising jobs, but you must have the credibility by your record.
To deliver.
That what he promises, he will deliver. Yeah. Modi had that combination, and Rahul Gandhi and all did not have that combination.
Right. Pavan, just looking ahead now, because that's the kind of general underlying theme of what we're talking about this evening. What's the future now for Nitish Kumar? A major error of judgment he made. He's a great politician. He's a good administrator. He is an implementer. He has changed Bihar in many ways. But he's down to 4 seats. What's the next year going to be? Is he going to lose his government as well? How do you see the next 6 months to a year unfolding for Nitish Kumar?
No, first of all, let me admit to you, Pranoy, that the results did come as a surprise to us. And let me take this opportunity also to congratulate the new government. Essentially, I think where perhaps our calculations went wrong was, as Arun Bhai himself said, people sort of segregated voting for a parliamentary election as against voting in a state assembly election. As you may perhaps be aware, Nitish Kumar himself enjoys a very high approval rating in terms of his impact in transforming Bihar. And in fact, paradoxically, while Mr. Modi claims this election was fought on the goal of development, if that is a goal, then Mr. Nitish Kumar has delivered more than the average and certainly in verifiable ways. But perhaps what happened was that there was a consolidation.
Pavan, let's not look at the past and what happened. I'm asking, just to change the debate a bit, the future. What is the future now for Nitish Kumar? Because his state government is going to be a bit wobbly. Anyway, it's kind of minority with support from various other parties. Tell me, how are things going to unfold over the next few months for Nitish Kumar?
Well, the way I see it, Pranoy, is that it's speculative to talk about what happens, but Mr. Nitish Kumar is very focused. He has done a lot for Bihar, but he has a lot more in the pipeline. He would like to work for that. And certainly, he will then work towards the assembly elections.
Will he be chief minister or will his government fall within the next year? 6 months to a year?
Pranoy, you know that in the political class, it's very difficult to answer a question put as bluntly as you have. Certainly, I will admit one thing. I must admit one thing. that we have received a setback in the parliamentary election. And I was only talking of the past in order to understand the future. One thing has become clear, that in this election, the caste silos have been breached.
Right.
So let me ask you. Religious silos have not.
Should Nitish Kumar dissolve his assembly and call for an election? Should he do that?
Prannoy, it's just today the election results have come out.
Right.
I think Mr. Nitish Kumar is a mass leader. He has in the past never held a particular political post as dear to him. You will recall he was railway minister and he had resigned when there was a rail accident. The party is internalizing the result, doing its own assessment and introspection. And I'm sure he will take a decision which is congruent to both what is politically strategic and what is ethically congruent.
Right, right. Okay, let's just go once more into more depth than we have here with Vikram Chandra, who understands the trends of this election. And what I've learned from listening to him today is a huge amount. So, Vikram, more nuggets for us?
Prannoy, you're being way too kind, but looking ahead at what parties like the JDU or the Congress Party or even the Bahujan Samaj Party, remember it got no seats, what can they do now to bounce back? They have a bit of a problem, because actually if you look at the trends and you look at what's happened on the map of India, there's today a saffron fortress. There's a saffron fortress around across the entire heartland of India, and it's going to be very tough to breach that. And if you can just look at the map and go into some of the states, Prannoy, 8 states in particular. These 8 states have each been virtually swept by the BJP, thanks to that swing that you were talking about. Let's just quickly take you through some of these states. Let's start off, for example, with Uttar Pradesh, which, of course, we know about, 73 seats there for the BJP out of 80, a complete decimation of everybody else, including the Bahujan Samaj Party and others. That's state number one. Then let's go to Bihar, where it's 29 seats there in Bihar right now for the BJP, extending that saffron fortress towards the east. Come down, come to a place like Jharkhand, 12 seats there. It's a complete BJP sweep, just one seat being won by somebody else. Then as we start moving towards the west, you come to Chhattisgarh. Again, a complete sweep by the BJP, only one seat being won by anybody else. Madhya Pradesh next. Madhya Pradesh, the Congress always used to pick up 2 or 3 seats. Not this time, just 2 seats being picked up, including Jyotiraditya's seat up there. 27 out of 29 for them there. Perhaps the biggest shock for the Congress party would be in Maharashtra. The Congress reduced and the NCP reduced to just those 2 or 3 little pockets out there. Otherwise, it's 44 seats. 44 seats for the BJP and the Shiv Sena and the other allies there. And a complete sweep in Gujarat, all 26 seats. A complete sweep then in Rajasthan. So if you add all of this together, Prannoy, just these super 8 states that I spoke about add up to 247 seats for the BJP alliance. And you add Andhra Pradesh and, you know, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand, that takes them to the halfway mark. So that saffron fortress now across the entire heartland of India, how these parties are going to come back and try and storm that whenever the next election is of course what they have to now debate and discuss.
Vikram, you're a young man. Have you ever seen an election as dramatic and as big a landslide with swings like this?
1984, perhaps. I was younger then. I'm now very soon, I'm approaching the wrong side of that divide that you were talking about. Much, much younger, 84. But Prannoy, you know, we heard Narendra Modi saying this also, the sort of a first time we've got a prime minister who was born after independence, and the sort of a surge that we've seen this time, first time a non-Congress party has got an absolute majority on its own in the history of India. So that really shows just how landmark an election this was.
Right. Okay, thanks very, very much indeed, Vikram. We'll take a short break now. When we come back, we'll look at the relationship between this dominant party and dominant alliance at the center and the states, and which ones are wobbly and what will the strategy be between the center and these states. That's in a moment from now. We'll be right back. Just look at that parliament dominated by the BJP and its alliance partners. Just look at the way it crosses the halfway mark, and the other parties, the Congress on the extreme left in blue, the AIDMK, the TMC and the BJD are tucked away in one corner. And of those alliance partners and the BJP, 73 have come from one state, Uttar Pradesh. 73. Nobody, I don't even think the man of the match, Amit Shah, imagined that the BJP would get 73 seats. Right now, he's sitting with Barkha Dutt. Let's go straight across to them.
Prannoy, thanks very much. Think of this, that those 73 seats in Uttar Pradesh for the BJP are higher than the tally of the Congress party nationally. I think when you juxtapose those two figures, it tells the story of this election. And as we've been saying, Amit Shah here with me has delivered that absolutely majestic performance for the BJP in Uttar Pradesh. Amit ji, bahut bahut badhai, sabse pehle. और बहुत माना जाता है कि एक तरफ अगर नरेंद्र मोदी कैप्टन थे तो आप हीरो रहे उनके साथ.
नहीं, हीरो जैसे हजारों कार्यकर्ताओं ने काफी काम किया है और विशेषकर उत्तर प्रदेश में तो मान लीजिए कार्यकर्ता जान पर आकर पार्टी को पुनर्जीवित करने के लिए मैदान में था.
लेकिन आप गुजरात से आए, उत्तर प्रदेश एक प्रदेश था जो आप जानते नहीं थे. इट वॉज अ न्यू स्टेट फॉर यू. स्टेट यूनिट में थोड़ी रेजिस्टेंस भी थी शुरू में. आपके लिए सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज क्या रहा और आपको कोई एस्टिमेट था कि आप 70 से ऊपर जा सकते हैं?
नहीं, 70 का तो एस्टिमेट नहीं सोचा था, मगर हम इतना निश्चित मानते थे. हमारा स्टेट यूनिट ने जो आकलन करा, हमारा आंतरिक आकलन 62 तक पहुंचता था, मगर हमने थोड़ा इसको
कंजर्वेटिव
करके 55 का आंकड़ा तो हम बिल्कुल निश्चित तौर से मतलब न्यूज में भी कहते थे कि हम 55 के आसपास सीट पाएंगे.
अगर हम 1990s के बारे में सोचें, जब बीजेपी की पहली अयोध्या मूवमेंट के टाइम पर पहली एक तरह से असेंडेंसी हुई थी उत्तर प्रदेश में, उससे भी कहीं ज्यादा आज विकास के मुद्दे पर लड़ते हुए आपको सीट मिली है. वॉट डू यू थिंक इज द मेन रीजन फॉर योर सक्सेस इन उत्तर प्रदेश खासकर?
देखिये, उत्तर प्रदेश की जनता 15 सालों से ये जातीय राजनीति करने वाली सरकारों से उब चुकी थी, क्योंकि विकास का एजेंडा काफी पीछे चला गया था
जी.
कभी किसी की सरकार आई तो किसी जाति को फायदा पहुंचाने का प्रयास हुआ, दूसरी सरकार आई तो किसी एक जाति को फायदा पहुंचाने का प्रयास हुआ, मगर कुल मिलाकर पूरे उत्तर प्रदेश की जनता को उठाने का प्रयास किसी सरकार ने नहीं किया. और हजारों लोग हर रोज उत्तर प्रदेश से गुजरात जाते हैं रोजगार के लिए जाते हैं और वो वापिस उत्तर प्रदेश में भी आते हैं. उन्होंने वहां जो विकास मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकार ने किया था और वहां की स्थिति जो देखी थी, वो वहां से यहां वापिस आने वाले उत्तर प्रदेश के निवासियों, जो वापिस आए निवासी
जी,
वो उत्तर प्रदेश में गुजरात के एम्बेसडर बनकर आए, मोदी के एम्बेसडर बनकर आए
जी.
और एक भूमि तैयार होकर पड़ी थी कि विकास की भूख उत्तर प्रदेश में देश में शायद सबसे ज्यादा.
पर आपको लगा था कि मायावती के जीरो सीट आएंगे?
देखिए, वैसे तो सभी पार्टी की जीरो है. कांग्रेस 2 जीती है, वो उनकी परंपरागत परिवार की सीटें हैं. और मुलायम सिंह जी की पार्टी भी जो 5 सीटें जीती है, वो भी पांचों उनकी खुद ही की सीट है. 2 सीट पर मुलायम खुद जीते हैं, 1 पर उनके बेटे की पत्नी जीती है और 2 पर उनके भतीजे जीते हैं
जी. आगे की बात करते हैं. सबसे पहले आप माने जाते हैं द सेकंड मोस्ट पावरफुल मैन इन द बीजेपी टुडे, अमित जी. बहुत लोग मानते हैं कि आपके बिना बीजेपी की ये आंकड़े नहीं आते. विल अमित शाह बी अ मेंबर ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट? विल ही बी इन द प्राइम मिनिस्टर्स ऑफिस कि आप संगठन में रहेंगे?
देखिये बरखा जी, पहले तो मैं एक बात स्पष्ट कर दूं कि मैं ऐसा कोई वहम मेरे मन में नहीं पालता कि मैं बीजेपी में नंबर 2 हूं.
पर आप हैं?
जी नहीं, ये वास्तविकता नहीं है. मैं काफी जूनियर कार्यकर्ता हूं. मैं बीजेपी का राष्ट्रीय महासचिव निश्चित हूं. और जहां तक मेरी भूमिका का सवाल है, ये आज तक मेरे जीवन में मेरी सभी भूमिकाओं को, सभी काम की तरीकों को पार्टी ने ही तय किया है, जब कभी भी किया है. आगे पर ही भी पार्टी ही तय करेगी और जो पार्टी तय करेगी वो मैं निश्चित रूप से बड़े मन से और चाव से.
आप क्या प्रेफर करेंगे, गवर्नमेंट की पार्टी?
नहीं, मैं मेरा प्रेफरेंस कहकर पार्टी को दबाव में लाना नहीं चाहता. ना मैं कभी इस तरीके से पार्टी के हमारी आंतरिक चर्चा में भी मेरा प्रेफरेंस कहता हूं, क्योंकि कहीं ना कहीं बाद में
पार्टी पर भी दबाव बनता है, मैं ऐसा नहीं चाहता।
आपसे पूछना चाहूंगी कि शायद पहली बारी आज ये हुआ है कि एक प्रेसिडेंशियल स्टाइल कैंपेन है जिसमें नरेंद्र मोदी की वेव मानी जा रही है, आप क्या मानेंगे कि कुछ जो बाकी लीडर्स हैं जैसे अडवाणी जी या सुषमा स्वराज जो कि कहते हैं ये बीजेपी की भी जीत है, ये कार्यकर्ताओं की भी जीत है, ये आरएसएस की भी जीत है, ये एक तरह से एक अपनी जो पुरानी उनकी थोड़ी टेंशन रही है मोदी जी के साथ उनको एक्सप्रेस कर रहे हैं?
नहीं, सभी लोग मानते हैं इंक्लूडिंग मोदी जी के भारतीय जनता पार्टी के लाखों लाखों कार्यकर्ताओं की जीत है और विशेषकर 125 करोड़ भारतवासियों की जीत है।
मोदी जी इज नॉट बिगर देन द बीजेपी।
मोदी जी ने अभी अपने भाषण में कहा है कि ये पूरे देश की जनता की जीत है, तो ये भाव पार्टी के सभी कार्यकर्ताओं का है और मोदी जी का भी है।
थोड़ा बताइए कि अडवाणी जी के रोल को लेकर थोड़ी चिंता रही है, सुषमा जी के रोल को लेकर थोड़ी चिंता रही है, माना जाते हैं वो दोनों ही थोड़ा नाराज हैं।
आप चिंता मत करिए, मेरी पार्टी चिंता कर रही है और पार्टी सबको साथ में लेकर आगे बढ़ती है, मोदी जी भी सबको साथ में लेकर आगे बढ़ रहे हैं।
आगे की बात करें, आज मोदी जी ने अपने भाषण में कहा कि जिन्होंने हमारे लिए वोट नहीं भी किया उनको भी साथ लेकर चलना है, बीजेपी की क्या कोशिश रहेगी, किस तरह से आप रीच आउट करेंगे?
देखिए, रीच आउट करने का पॉलिटिकल फायदे के लिए रीच आउट करना ये भारतीय जनता पार्टी की संस्कृति नहीं है। हम कोई मत बैंक खड़ी करने के लिए सरकार नहीं चलाते हैं। जब सरकार चलती है तब सरकार के सामने पक्ष विपक्ष कुछ नहीं होता, किसने हमें वोट दिया किसको हमें वोट नहीं दिया वो नहीं होता। गुजरात के अंदर, मध्य प्रदेश के अंदर, छत्तीसगढ़ के अंदर, जहां जहां हमारी सरकार लंबे अरसे तक चली वहां ये सिद्ध हुआ है कि हमने सरकार को बहुत पवित्रता से एक वेलफेयर स्टेट बनाने के मिशन के रूप में काम करने का एक साधन माना है और इसी तरह से हमने काम किया है।
एक प्रायोरिटी, क्योंकि अब आप सरकार में हैं, एक प्रायोरिटी रहेगी कि जो मुसलमान वोटर डरता था बीजेपी से उसको कैसे साथ लेकर चला जाए, आप मानेंगे कि ये बीजेपी के लिए एक सीरियस प्रॉब्लम है?
देखिए, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, किसी को डरने की जरूरत भी नहीं है। एक मीडिया के कुछ सेक्शन में जिसमें आपका भी चैनल आता है उसने प्रचारित की हुई बात है, ये तथ्य नहीं है।
आपको नहीं लगता कि मुसलमान वोटर डरता है?
पूरा मुझे सुन लीजिए ना, बिल्कुल एक भ्रांति खड़ी हुई है, मैं यही कहता हूँ। मीडिया के एक सेक्शन ने और विशेषकर आपकी चैनल ने एक भ्रांति खड़ी करी है। जब 5 साल हमारी सरकार चलेगी और किसी के साथ कोई भेदभाव नहीं होगा, सबको अपना अधिकार मिलेगा और किसी के साथ अन्याय भी नहीं होगा, तो अपने आप वो भ्रम का निरसन हो जाएगा और जो अंतर अभी दिखाई पड़ता है वो अंतर भी दूर हो जाएगा।
पहले 100 दिन, यूजुअली एक सरकार अपने 100 डेज को बहुत सीरियसली लेती है, सबसे बड़ी प्रायोरिटी क्या रहेगी बीजेपी के लिए?
चलिए बरखा जी, ये सवाल आपने मोदी जी को पूछना चाहिए, मुझे गलत पूछ रहे हैं, मगर मैं इतना जरूर मानता हूं कि हमें 5 साल का मैंडेट मिला है, उसको 100 दिन, 200 दिन, 300 दिन कर 5 साल के समय को बांटना नहीं चाहिए। बड़ी विकराल समस्या है, जाने वाली सरकार ने खड़ी की हुई है और 5 साल के मैंडेट के समय के अंदर ही, संवैधानिक आयुष्य के अंदर ही हमने जो वादे किए हैं वो हम निश्चित रूप से पूरा कर पाएंगे, ऐसा मेरी पार्टी का भरोसा है और मेरा भी भरोसा है।
अमित जी, आई नो प्रणोय विल हैव अ क्वेश्चन फॉर यू, पर एक मेरा सवाल बिफोर आई हैंड इट टू द स्टूडियो। आपने कहा यूपी में जहां जहां कांग्रेस जीती है वो फैमिली कांग्रेस की है, रायबरेली अमेठी जैसे, और मुलायम का अभी आपने कहा समाजवादी पार्टी का भी वही हाल है। राहुल गांधी ने आज एक लाइन का बयान दिया कि आई टेक रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी, ये मेरी गलती है आपको, और दूसरी तरफ कांग्रेस के नेताओं ने कहा नहीं, ये सरकार की गलती है, राहुल गांधी की गलती नहीं है, तो आप इस पे क्या टिप्पणी देंगे?
देखिए, जग जाहिर है कि सरकार कौन चला रहा था, अब तो ये बात छिपी नहीं है
जी।
मनमोहन सिंह जी निश्चित रूप से प्रधानमंत्री थे, मगर सरकार तो जनपद से ही चल रही थी, सबको मालूम है
जी।
और मैं मानता हूं कि अच्छा स्पिरिट है सोनिया जी और राहुल जी का, जिन्होंने जिम्मेदारी को स्वीकार किया है, क्योंकि पार्टी के नेतृत्व की ही जिम्मेदारी अंततोगत्वा तो सरकार की विफलता के लिए होती है।
आगे चलते हुए जो एक बिटरनेस थी इस कैंपेन में, कुछ लोगों ने कहा कि बहुत ही एक तरह से जैसे युद्ध होता है वैसे ये कैंपेन थी, क्या अब वो समय आ गया है कि टेम्परेचर कूल डाउन होंगे?
देखिए, बिटरनेस का जहां तक सवाल है, पूरा कैंपेन कोई बिटरनेस के आधार पर नहीं चला, 1-2% बिटरनेस वाली बातें हुई होगी, हमेशा होती है, कोई ये पहली बार नहीं हुआ है, मगर मीडिया ने वो 1-2% को ही ज्यादा उछाला। मान लीजिए 45 मिनट का भाषण है, पूरा 45 मिनट में से 40 मिनट का भाषण एजेंडे पे चला और 1-2 मिनट कोई सटायर टाइप की बात आ गई तो मीडिया ने उसी को एक ठीक है, मीडिया का अपना एक रोल है, मगर मैं निश्चित रूप से मानता हूं ना बिटरनेस की शुरुआत हमने की थी, ना हम इसको एक्सटेंड करना चाहते हैं, और सरकार विपक्ष और पक्ष दोनों को साथ में लेकर देश के विकास के साथ सबको जोड़ने का निश्चित रूप से एक प्रामाणिक प्रयास करें।
अमित जी, आरएसएस का क्या रोल रहेगा? पिछले 24 घंटों में हमने देखा बहुत सारे आरएसएस के सीनियर लीडर्स ने मीटिंग्स भी की, इसमें आप क्या मानेंगे कि आरएसएस का रोल रहेगा जो नई सरकार नई कैबिनेट बनने जा रही है?
देखिये बरखा जी, आप बड़ी सीनियर जर्नलिस्ट हैं, कई बार भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकारें बनी है, देश में भी बनी है, राज्यों में भी बनी है, हर बार ये विषय आता है कि आरएसएस का क्या रोल रहेगा। एक बात मैं बड़ी कैटेगोरिकली स्पष्ट करना चाहता हूं कि भारतीय जनता पार्टी के सभी नीतिगत फैसले भारतीय जनता पार्टी स्वयं करती है,
तो आरएसएस का कोई रोल नहीं रहेगा इसमें।
मैं फिर से एक बार मेरी बात कहूंगा कि भारतीय जनता पार्टी के सभी नीतिगत फैसले भारतीय जनता पार्टी स्वयं करती है।
भारतीय जनता पार्टी की बात करें तो आज बहुत अच्छा दिन रहा आपके लिए, सिर्फ एक बैड न्यूज था, वो अरुण जेटली की जो अमृतसर की सीट थी उसके बारे में आपका कुछ ख्याल? क्या अरुण जेटली का जो रोल रहेगा आगे, उस ये जो डिफीट उनकी पर्सनल हुई है, कुछ फर्क पड़ेगा उससे?
कोई सवाल ही नहीं है अरुण जेटली के रोल में फर्क पड़ने का। अरुण जेटली जी हमारे वरिष्ठ नेता थे, हैं और रहेंगे। ऐसा प्रमुख नेता है अरुण जेटली हमारी पार्टी का, जिसे एक छोटी से हार से कोई उनकी इमेज मलाइन होने का सवाल ही नहीं पैदा होता। बरखा जी, ये देश को बड़ा कंट्रीब्यूट कर पाए इस प्रकार का एक हमारा नेतृत्व तो है, और मैं मानता हूं कि ऐसे लोगों की राजनीति में जरूर है और देश को भी जरूर है।
अमित जी, प्रणॉय ऑल्सो हैज अ क्वेश्चन फॉर यू। प्रणॉय प्लीज गो अहेड।
अमित जी, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल मेनी मेनी कंग्रेचुलेशंस। व्हेन वी मेट इन Uttar Pradesh, we thought you'd get about 55
Thank
seats,
you very much.
And you've got 73. A fantastic achievement. Many congratulations. Beyond your expectations. So I just wanted to ask you, looking ahead, because our program is about looking ahead rather than causes of victory or defeat. What is your relationship going to be with the states? Some states, the chief ministers have lost their mandate in a sense. They, like say in Bihar, the BJP and its allies have done have swept that state, and other states as well, Uttar Pradesh as well. Are you going to be focused on trying to win these states? Is it going to be a part of your strategy over the next few years?
मुझे ठीक से सुनाई नहीं पड़ा।
अमित जी, मैं बताती हूँ। प्रणॉय इज आस्किंग कि ऐसे जो स्टेट्स हैं जहां पर डिफीट्स हुई हैं, जैसे बिहार देख लीजिए नीतीश कुमार, या उत्तर प्रदेश देख लीजिए मुलायम सिंह यादव, विल यू बी डिमांडिंग न्यू असेंबली इलेक्शंस की एज अ सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट आप इन चीफ मिनिस्टर्स इन मुख्यमंत्रियों के साथ आप कोऑपरेट करेंगे?
नहीं नहीं, कोई नए इलेक्शन की डिमांड करने का सवाल ही नहीं है। भारतीय जनता पार्टी इसके देश के संविधान में श्रद्धा रखती है, हमारे फेडरल स्ट्रक्चर को क्षति पहुंचे ऐसा कोई काम भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकार के और से होने का सवाल ही नहीं है।
पर जैसे नीतीश कुमार का एग्जांपल ले लीजिए, अब वो कुछ देर तक तो रहेंगे बिहार के मुख्यमंत्री, विल द न्यू सेंटर कोऑपरेट विद हिम?
निश्चित रूप से बिहार की जनता ने भारतीय जनता पार्टी को एक बिल्कुल आप कह सकते हैं बहुत बड़ा मैंडेट दिया है, और भारतीय जनता पार्टी के लगभग लगभग सभी प्रत्याशी को जीता है। बिहार की जनता के साथ अन्याय करने का ना किसी को अधिकार है, ना हम करने देंगे। और जहां तक बिहार की सरकार का भी सवाल है, बिहार के विकास के लिए जो कुछ भी करने जैसा है वो सब हमारी सरकार आगे उनकी मदद में रहेगी, और कोई भेदभाव पूर्ण कार्यवाही सरकार की ओर से नहीं
है। अमित जी, देयर इज अनदर क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम द स्टूडियो। प्रणॉय प्लीज गो अहेड।
शेखर गुप्ता वांट्स टू आस्क अ क्वेश्चन सर।
अमित भाई, आपको बहुत बहुत बधाई, सब बधाई दे रहे हैं, तो मेरी तरफ से भी
जी शेखर जी
आपको बधाई। जो सवाल पहले पूछा गया उसको मैं एक और तरीके से पूछता हूं। आपको यूपी भेजा गया था यूपी को बीजेपी के लिए जीतने के लिए, क्योंकि यूपी के बिना भारत पे शासन नहीं होता। आपका मिशन यूपी अभी कंप्लीट हो गया है या अभी आधा हुआ है?
नहीं, जहां तक मिशन यूपी का सवाल है, उत्तर प्रदेश यूनिट हमारा निश्चित मानता है कि भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकार आने वाले दिनों में उत्तर प्रदेश में बननी चाहिए, और मैं भी मानता हूं कि उत्तर प्रदेश राष्ट्र की मुख्य धारा के साथ जुड़े तो उसमें उत्तर प्रदेश का भी भला है और देश का भी भला है।
अमित जी, आपका फोकस कहां रहेगा? टू स्ट्रेंथन द कार्डर मोर इन उत्तर प्रदेश, टू लुक एट अदर स्टेट्स जहां पे बीजेपी की आप परफॉर्मेंस इम्प्रूव करना चाहेंगे?
देखिये बरखा जी, सरकार बनने जा रही है, स्वाभाविक रूप से काफी फेरबदल भारतीय जनता पार्टी के आंतरिक संगठन में होंगे। उसके बाद में राष्ट्रीय अध्यक्ष जी जो मेरे लिए फैसला करेंगे उस हिसाब से मैं काम करूंगा, मगर मैं इतना निश्चित मानता हूं कि आने वाले दिनों में उत्तर प्रदेश भारतीय जनता पार्टी का यूनिट एक मजबूत यूनिट के रूप में उभरेगा और हम आने वाले चुनाव में निश्चित रूप से भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकार बनाएंगे।
अमित जी, लुकिंग अहेड, आज दुनिया भर के लीडर्स ने नरेंद्र मोदी जी को बधाई देने के लिए फोन किया। पाकिस्तान से भी फोन आया, नवाज शरीफ का फोन आया, उन्होंने तो न्योता भी दे दिया कि मोदी जी पाकिस्तान आए। अब आप ऑपोजिशन में नहीं, अब आप सरकार बनाने जा रहे हैं, ये बहुत डेलिकेट इश्यूज हो जाते हैं, तो इसको लेकर क्या सोच है कि क्या एक नेबरहुड पॉलिसी रहेगी बीजेपी की?
देखिए, देश की विदेश नीति सातत्यपूर्ण होनी चाहिए ऐसा मेरी पार्टी मानती है। सरकारें बदलने के साथ देश की विदेश नीति में कोई भारी नीतिगत बदलाव नहीं होता, मगर इतना निश्चित होगा कि देश की विदेश नीति की दो बुनियादें हम जरूर स्ट्रेंथी करना चाहेंगे, देश का सम्मान और देश की सुरक्षा। इसके आधार पर ही देश की विदेश नीति में जो थोड़े बहुत बदलाव करने की जरूरत है वो होगी।
अमित जी, एक आखिरी सवाल, मोदी जी ने हमेशा कहा, आपने भी कहा, कि कोई विंडिक्टिवनेस, कोई विच हंट नहीं होगा, लेकिन कोई किसी को इम्यूनिटी भी नहीं दी जा सकती। तो मैं पूछूंगी कि बहुत से मुद्दे उठे, रॉबर्ट वाड्रा का मुद्दा भी उठा कैंपेन के दौरान, आपने भी उठाया, मोदी जी ने, बीजेपी ने उठाया, अब जब नंबर्स आपके साथ हैं, इस इश्यू को लेकर आप लोगों का क्या अप्रोच रहेगा?
आपके सवाल में ही जवाब आ गया, सवाल की शुरुआत ही आपने जवाब से की है कि हम विंडिक्टिवनेस से कोई कार्यवाही नहीं करेंगे, न्यायपूर्ण कार्यवाही सबके साथ होगी, किसी को अन्याय नहीं होगा।
अमित जी, वी हैव टू एंड हियर, मेनी मेनी कंग्रेचुलेशंस। आप नहीं माने कि आप नंबर टू हैं, लेकिन आज का दिन बीजेपी के लिए जो हुआ है वो आपके बिना और उत्तर प्रदेश की परफॉर्मेंस के बिना नहीं होता।
चलिए, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद बरखा जी।
थैंक यू अमित जी एंड प्रणोय एंड शेखर, इट्स हैंडिंग इट बैक टू यू इन द स्टूडियो।
थैंक यू वेरी मच इंडीड। I guess, Arun, when you were talking about one of the key factors of the next government is implementation and execution of projects, Amit Shah is a crucial player in that.
Yes, but I think the point that he was making is a more general one. This is Modi's theme also. See, you cannot govern India by not cooperating with the state chief ministers. Actually speaking, it's been Modi's good message also, because everybody was saying he's authoritarian, and he became the champion of partnership with the chief ministers, always saying we'll run the governments together. You want to implement infrastructure projects, Delhi Bombay rail corridor, you can't do it without the chief ministers,
right?
You want to improve public distribution system, you want to improve health delivery, you can't do it without chief ministers.
GST,
well, second is, if you want to do it, second is that the in the case of the chief ministers are facing the same problems as the prime minister is facing, and they are gravitating to the same solutions. If you take mining, if you take anything, clearances, ease of doing business, so cooperating with the chief ministers must be one of the most important things, and I think it's very good to begin even optically. For instance, for the annual plan discussions, why does the chief minister come to Delhi? Why does the planning commission not go to the state? After all, those chief ministers are running states
more
bigger than Western Europe countries. Similarly, National Development Council meeting takes place, prime minister up sitting on a dais, others sitting down. Why not at a round table? Why hold it in Delhi? Why not circulate it among states? Similarly, revive the interstate council. So, really?
These are actually issues that are perception and are important, because they affect everybody's attitude.
And secondly, even touring. I'm sure Modi will tour a lot, as we have seen his energy now. It's a very strange fact. We say we are a continent, multilingual, multicultural. But after Pandit ji, touring by Indian prime ministers has stopped. Why not visit the states?
Yes, yes. And actually, the old prime minister used to visit big infrastructure projects to make sure they were done. That,
yes.
Those days are gone.
So
we are joined now.
Letters to chief
ministers. Chief ministers.
All the time.
Fortnightly letters.
Okay, we are joined now
by hike of the Chinese wall.
Right, Ashwini Kumar. Ashwini Kumar, it's been a terrible day for the Congress party. Decimated. We're looking ahead. What are you going to do to get out of this trough? And it is a deep, deep trough.
I agree with you, Prannoy. This has been a very devastating defeat. It is not an ordinary result. It must say a lot to us. And we must begin by deep, serious, purposive and honest introspection, as deep as it is required to go.
We think need it'll happen?
Basic surgery, but what we... Well, I hope it will happen because too much is at stake. There is no escape from it. We have to recreate that emotional bond between our party and the people of India. And whatever it takes to do that, we'll have to do it. Now the question is, how do we improve our communication? How do we improve our organizational strength? I think the starting point will have to be to begin grooming thought leaders in the states who will have a resonance with the people of their states, credibility, intellectual and political integrity. These were all at a discount for various reasons, for reasons that are now historical. And I think the Congress leadership is fully seized of what is now required to be done. And I hope it will be done sooner than later. Because the strength of the Congress, either in the opposition or as a ruling party, is necessary for a vibrant democracy in this country. We are moving towards a unipolar pole of politics, which is not good for a democracy. So I grant to Mr. Narendra Modi what he has done. He has succeeded in presenting himself at the head of a sentiment, and that sentiment was for change, that sentiment was for decisive government and for stability, for a government which is not hostage to the inherent contradictions and the pulls and pressures of a coalition politics. The people of India saw our discomfort in the last 1 or 2 years in a very visible way. And the people of India, in their wisdom, decided that they will vote for a stable government. Now, we did not get that support because of the anti-incumbency against us. And there's a lot more which we have to examine and then move forward. But we'll come back. We will come back. We have come back in the past. We'll come back again. We don't have to be despondent.
Well, Mr. Ashwini Kumar, first of all, how do we share your confidence that your party thinks like this, your party high command thinks like this? Because I do not believe, and please don't get me wrong, I do not believe that they listen to you or they even have the patience to start introspection so soon. That's one. Second, your party has more serious problems. Because even look at the part of the country you come from, Punjab, and the part of the country where you live, Delhi. These are two of Congress Party's strongholds. In these two, Congress Party's space has actually been taken away by a new party, by Aam Aadmi Party. In many of the seats in these states, Congress Party has finished third. And that's not a trend that is weakening. In fact, in Delhi Assembly elections, you are way behind Aam Aadmi Party. And again in Parliament, in all the seats, Aam Aadmi Party is number two. So you have now, you are getting hit from both sides.
I agree with you, Shekhar, on the second point. The emergence of AAP is a political development that has to be factored in. And I can tell you, but for AAP,
but when will you, when
Akali Dal would have been completely swept away.
But when will your party factor it in the next five-year plan starting 2019? Until then, you'll be building the Youth Congress.
They have to factor in now. There is an urgency. And the reason I say they are going to do it is not because they are obliged to listen to me. And I never claim to be the only advisor. But I do speak my mind. I know that Mrs. Gandhi is a thoughtful leader. She's a thoughtful person. The message of this electoral verdict is certainly not lost on her. And since we have a sense of history, we have an all India presence, we have to rejuvenate it. We have to put it together, some new people, some old experienced people, but more important, the vision, the thought. We have to factor in the tectonic shift that is taking place. We did not gauge the measure in its true proportion. So much was happening around us. We knew something was wrong, but not to this extent. And right. I think we'll learn from the mistake. Right. You must grant us that right. The right to learn and to learn fast.
Ashwini Kumar, Arun Shori has a question and a comment for you.
Well, I'm a friend of Ashwini's, as he knows. Ashwini ji, the reason for sharing Shekhar's skepticism is that actually you have the leadership, the top leadership has proclaimed its determination to introspect after the UP debacle, after Bihar. Mrs. Gandhi said that we will go back to the drawing board. You have not, there is no evidence of introspection after the four states, no introspection after Delhi losing it to AAP. So to just tell us, 5 years from now, what do you think? Would you actually have gone through this process? Do you think some results would have emerged of the kind that you are saying, that state leaders would at last be allowed to come up, which after Mrs. Indira Gandhi's time, they have not been allowed to come up? On that one point, do you think there will be a change?
Arun, all I can say, Arun, is that there's a tipping point in the lives of political parties as in the life of individuals. Certain decisions that ought to have been taken earlier, more measures could have been taken in the past, I can concede all of that. But that does not mean that we are not going to be starting now. We are certainly not unmindful of what this result of a Lok Sabha election on an all India basis has done to us as a political party. Therefore, the gravity of the situation is such that it has to impel urgent and purposive action. It can't be any other way unless we are on a suicide course. And I can tell you, we are not on a suicide course. We know what is at stake for the country. We know what is at stake for us as a political party. But yes, I agree with you that it cannot be business as usual. Something fundamentally transformative will require to be done. Whether it will happen or not, I am an optimist. I will hope for the best, but only time will tell.
I'm sorry to be so direct, but time for contemplating suicide is over. It's time to contemplate rebirth, if you so wish to. And you've seen the point that Arun made just now. If you empower a state leader, a good state, strong state leader, and say, go ahead, deliver something for me, very often, he may do it. I mean, you've seen Amritsar. But at the same time, you find in your party, nobody can name five leaders who can get between themselves, even in a good election. This was not a good election for your party.
Shekhar, take the example of Jagan Reddy. I mean, he was an extremely popular leader after his father.
And he was punished for it.
Punished for it.
Now, how dare you be popular? And
You committed suicide in Andhra Pradesh.
And may I say may I say one other thing? I think it's very necessary to remember, it's not a communication failure. The failure is in substance. And secondly, please remember that cleverness doesn't pay. There were so many clever people, and that's a lesson for all parties. But certainly also, just see many of the persons who were, by thinking that you have answered something on Prannoy's program for the evening or managed tomorrow's headline, doesn't mean that you have managed the situation. People are wiser now than they were.
Actually, on that, we just have to go into a break right now. And thank you very much, Ashwini Kumar.
Thank you.
We just go into a break.
Thank you very much.
The words from Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi after this devastating defeat. Does it really give you a sense that there's going to be introspection? Just these few words, you judge. And after that, we'll come back and talk to another couple of big men of matches. They've been big heroes from different states today. We'll be talking to Shivraj Chauhan and to the Chandra Babu Naidu, the comeback kid. That's in a moment from now. But first, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi.
I'd like to start by congratulating the new government. They've been given a mandate by the people of our country. So I wish the new government all the best. From my part, Congress party has done pretty badly. There's a lot for us to think about. And as vice president of the party, I hold myself responsible for what has happened. Thank you.
Lok Sabha ke natije हमारे सामने हैं. कांग्रेस ने अपनी उपलब्धियों, नीतियों और सिद्धांतों के आधार पर इस चुनाव में अपने विरोधियों का सामना किया, फिर भी वह समर्थन हमें नहीं मिला जिसकी हम आशा कर रहे थे। हम ये मानते हैं कि लोकतंत्र में हार जीत होती रहती है। यह जनादेश स्पष्ट रूप में हमारे खिलाफ है, हमारी पार्टी के खिलाफ है। हम मतदाताओं के इस फैसले का विनम्रता के साथ आदर करते हैं, लेकिन इसके साथ ही हम यह आशा भी करते हैं कि केंद्र में जो सरकार बनेगी, यह भारतीय समाज की एकता और देश के हितों के साथ समझौता नहीं करेगी। मैं नई सरकार को अभी से बधाई देती हूँ। जहाँ तक कांग्रेस का प्रश्न है, भारतीय राष्ट्रीय कांग्रेस अपनी परंपरा, बुनियादी सिद्धांतों और आदर्शों के लिए हमेशा संघर्ष करेगी और उनके साथ कभी समझौता नहीं करेगी। हमें जो भी समर्थन मिला है उसके लिए मैं मतदाताओं और अपनी पार्टी के सभी कार्यकर्ताओं को धन्यवाद देती हूँ। मैं पार्टी की अध्यक्ष हूँ, इसीलिए हार की जिम्मेदारी मैं स्वीकार करती हूँ।
Welcome back. We are actually looking ahead now, not looking at what caused this landslide victory, and asking some of the major players who had a great day today, what are they going to do? First, we are joined by Shivraj Chauhan, the man of the match from Madhya Pradesh, absolute landslide. Congratulations, sir. Many, many congratulations. What a huge victory. I'm going to ask you, we're talking about things ahead, but I'm going to ask you, three reasons for your outstanding victory and what you are planning to do ahead. But first, give us three reasons for this amazing victory in Madhya Pradesh.
Number one, mani Narendra Modi ji ka chamatkarik netratv. Aur number two, Bharatiya Janata Party ke karyakartaon ne, samarthakon ne, Rajnath ji ke netratv mein anathak parishram kiya aur संघ ने भी यह तय किया कि किसी भी हालत में देश को अगर बचाना है तो बदलाव लाना है। ऐसे लाखों लाख कार्यकर्ता जुटे। और तीसरी बात, कांग्रेस ने जो राजनीति की वो बहुत नकारात्मक की। उन्होंने देश का विकास की तरफ ध्यान नहीं दिया। महंगाई, बेरोजगारी, भ्रष्टाचार, इसको रोकने में वो नाकाम रहे। राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा पर प्रश्न चिन्ह खड़े हो गए। अब जो उनका काम था वो काम छोड़ के वो मोदी जी के विरोध में लग गए, या जो विरोधी सरकारें थी, भाजपा शासित या दूसरी सरकारें, वहां कैसे उनको डिस्टर्ब करें इस काम में लगे रहे। अगर कहीं किसी ने असहमति के स्वर निकाले तो किसी को ठग कहा, किसी को और कुछ कहा। तो मैं मानता हूं कि जनता इस नकारात्मक राजनीति को पसंद नहीं करती। वो लोगों को निपटाने की कोशिश करते रहे, लोगों ने उन्हीं को हटा दिया।
आई जस्ट वांट टू नाउ गो टू द पॉइंट अबाउट लुकिंग अहेड। गिव अस थ्री चैलेंजेस दैट यू आर फेसिंग एंड द बीजेपी विल फेस, and how you plan to solve them, just looking ahead over the next 6 months, 1 year, 2 years.
मैं मानता हूं कि एक ही चुनौती है देश का को प्रगति और विकास के पथ पर ले जाना, पूरे देश को साथ खड़ा करना। कांग्रेस ने, यूपीए ने और बाकी क्षेत्रीय दलों ने पूरे देश को टुकड़ों टुकड़ों में बांट दिया था। अब मोदी जी के नेतृत्व में पूरे देश को प्रगति और विकास के पथ पर ले जाने का काम होगा। और अकेला केंद्र काम नहीं करेगा। यूपीए की सरकार ने तो प्रदेश के साथ भेदभाव किया। जो भाजपा शासित राज्य, एनडीए शासित राज्य थे, उनकी प्रगति को बाधित करने का काम किया। अब हमारे सामने जो चुनौती है जिसको पूरा करेंगे मोदी जी, वो पूरे देश को साथ लेके चलने की है। और मुझे पूरा विश्वास है कि वो पूरे देश को साथ लेके चलेंगे। महंगाई को कंट्रोल करना है, समय थोड़ा लग सकता है, राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा का सवाल है, भ्रष्टाचार को मिटाना और विकास के पथ पर देश को तेज गति से आगे ले जाना है, और वो तब होगा जब केंद्र के साथ साथ राज्य सरकारें मिलकर काम करेगी, तब देश प्रगति और विकास के पथ पर बढ़ेगा। और मोदी जी एक राज्य के मुख्यमंत्री रहे, वो बखूबी जानते हैं कि राज्य बढ़ेंगे तभी देश बढ़ेगा। इसलिए न केवल भाजपा शासित राज्यों को न्याय मिलेगा, बल्कि बाकी भी जो राज्य एनडीए के अलावा भी जो सरकारें हैं उनको भी न्याय मिलेगा। सबको साथ लेंगे, टीम बनेगी और यही टीम फिर देश को विकास के पथ पर ले जाएगी।
सर, यू आर नाउ अ मेजर लीडर इन द पार्टी, यू फॉट ऑफ एंटी इनकम्बेंसी, यू आर एक्सट्रीमली पॉपुलर, वेरी हाई रेटिंग इन योर स्टेट। आई सी बिहाइंड यू पिक्चर्स ऑफ टू ग्रेट लीडर्स, मिस्टर अडवाणी एंड मिस्टर वाजपेयी। सो विद इन योर पार्टी पॉलिटिशियंस, लाइक एनी पॉलिटिशियंस, हैव एम्बिशंस। Isn't this a challenge that certain people in the party will be upset? How is the party going to handle that?
नहीं, कोई इंटरनल प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, इस विजय से सब अभिभूत हैं, पूरी एक टीम के रूप में काम करेंगे। मोदी जी के नेतृत्व, प्रधानमंत्री जी, मोदी जी प्रधानमंत्री होंगे और बाकी सब मिलके उनके साथ काम करेंगे। माननीय अडवाणी जी जैसे नेता हमारे मार्गदर्शक हैं, हमारे का मतलब ये कि मेरे भी हैं, मोदी जी के भी हैं, और पार्टी को खड़ा करने में उनकी अपनी अहम भूमिका है। उनका स्नेह मिलेगा, उनका मार्गदर्शन मिलेगा और कहीं कोई अपसेट नहीं है। मेरी सारे नेताओं से आज फोन पर चर्चा अलग अलग समय हुई है, कोई अपसेट नहीं है, कोई अप्रसन्न नहीं है, सब प्रसन्न है, सब अभिभूत है और सब मिलकर देश को आगे बढ़ाएंगे।
ओके, वन लास्ट थिंग, एनी चांस ऑफ यू कमिंग टू द सेंटर और यू डेडिकेटेड टू मध्य प्रदेश?
मैं ये मानता हूं कि मेरा राज्य मध्य प्रदेश, जिसके लिए मुझे जनादेश जनता ने दिया है, पार्टी ने मुझे भी मुख्यमंत्री घोषित करके चुनाव लड़ा था, तो मेरी प्राथमिकता और मेरी पार्टी की भी प्राथमिकता यही है कि मैं मध्य प्रदेश को तेज गति से प्रगति और विकास के पथ पर ले जाऊं। मैं ये मानता हूं कि 7.5 करोड़ जनता की जिंदगी में अगर मैंने मुस्कुराहट ला दी, उनका जीवन स्तर सुधार दिया, तो मैंने अपने देश की बड़ी सेवा कर ली और इसलिए मैं राज्य में ही काम करूंगा।
Well, that's a major, major statement. And congratulations again, and thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
आपको भी बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद.
Thank you, sir. Arun, just looking ahead, is that going to be a problem? I mean, we saw Jaswant Singh, and it was pretty tough on him. But when we talked to the leaders, they said, well, you know, it's happening too often and something had to be done. Is there going to be this old guard problem or?
I don't really think so, because Prannoy, if I may make a suggestion, we should really go back, the media should go back for over the last 1.5 years. Mm-hmm. How many problems have been manufactured somehow to wish away Modi? That, you know, that other leaders will not allow Modi to come. Oh, Modi's appeal does not go beyond Gujarat. Oh, Modi's appeal does not extend to rural India. Mm-hmm. Oh, he is just the Ashwamedh, the horse which is being sent around the states in the yagya which is held at the end, he will be sacrificed. All these things we used to be told. Mm-hmm. And actually everything just dispersed
the
like
the kind
fog.
Of stories you used to do when you were in the media.
Well, I don't think so.
No, well, I mean, it is the media's job to ask questions. No, and I think one should actually, I remember I heard you earlier.
If I was say so, sure. Now it was Muslims. And you actually, not you, I mean the media stoked that fear. What happened in many places like Bihar, as you were showing yesterday, from 45% to 70% Muslims going behind Lalu Yadav. If that has happened, you can be sure, if there is Muslim consolidation, there will be a Hindu consolidation.
Correct, yes.
And then you get these results.
Right.
So,
right.
Please, we must reflect. We are always asking others to reflect, but the media must also reflect. Is it not just manufacturing or imagining problems, not just asking right. questions?
Right. No, but Arun, I know you don't want, that this may be an uncomfortable question, or I don't think we are manufacturing a problem. Muslims are genuinely worried because in the entire MPs, MLAs, there are no Muslims being held. So they are worried, and isn't it a fair question to say, how are you going to address that? And if you ask me, in his victory rally, Mr. Modi actually addressed it. He said, I want to take everybody
no, but
with
now,
me.
No, but
so
see,
is that a
I'm
fair
sure.
question?
Yes, but you know, if I may make a suggestion,
yeah.
I believe, maybe I've traveled less than you have traveled, But I believe there is a fundamental change coming up among Muslims also, as in the rest of the population.
Right.
And if I may use your channel to request everyone to read two books. One is a book by Maulana Wahiduddin. I think it is one of the most important books written after independence. It's called Indian Muslims' Need for a Positive Outlook.
Right.
Second is a recently published book by Hassan Sarur, who used to be the London correspondent, I think, of the Hindu,
yes,
called India's Muslim Renaissance. And India's Muslim Spring.
Right.
Why is nobody talking about it?
Right.
It's there are changes, and we just don't want to see. I feel that they Muslims, you know, that's why Mulayam Singh and all are losing, because they are still stoking fear, and Modi was addressing aspirations, and I would not be surprised if they also resonated with the feeling that yes, we will look for new opportunities.
Can I just say one more book you should recommend? Shekhar Gupta's book.
Yes, of course. Indeed.
Things would not I have do for you, Shekhar.
He released it in Bombay.
Okay, we are now joined by another man of the match from Andhra Pradesh, Chandra Babu Naidu, who has been out in the wilderness for over 10 years, but fought and fought and fought when others would have given up, and he's back with a bang. Thank you very much, and many, many congratulations, sir. An amazing victory today. From the depths of despair, you never gave up. Now, I just want to ask you, you did a lot for Hyderabad. You were seen as a high-tech propagator. You created a high-tech city. But you also seen that you didn't do enough for the poor and the rural areas. Are you going to be now a chief minister, a high-tech chief minister, or a welfare chief minister for the poor?
No, as a matter of fact, after economic reforms, I concentrated on economic reforms. Thereby, I created wealth. Today in Telangana state, there is a surplus budget because of my developments. Today, I am concentrating development and also welfare simultaneously. This is my agenda. One side, I have to create wealth. And at the same time, this health has to go to the people. That is where I have to concentrate inclusive growth rate. There are so many problems in same Andhra. From foundation, I have to work now. There are so many issues. All these issues I have to address, and at the same time I have to put the state on growth track.
Right, sir. So I know you're in a bit of a hurry. I'll just ask you one more question. There is quite, I would say, slight or quite a lot of tension between the people of Seam Andhra, particularly those living in Telangana, in Hyderabad, and the people of Telangana. How are you going to handle this tension between the two states?
Now, this tension is very clear. It is created by Congress party for votes and also seats. They created all these problems. Ultimately, both regions, they didn't benefit. People thought listen to Congress party. It is a reality. Now, Telugu Desam party, as a matter of fact, from the beginning, we are for Telugu community. NTR started this political party. In Telangana and Seam Andhra, people are with us. They are all brothers. We are all brothers. So I had to build that harmony, and also I had to convince people both the regions. And at the same time, wherever there is necessary, we have to help each other and we have to grow further. That is the agenda. That harmony I want to bring. In Telangana, better than Congress, we have performed. That is the confidence public are having with us. So I have to keep up that confidence.
Excellent. Right, sir. Thank you very much. And once again, many congratulations for the big comeback. Thank you very much for joining us.
With all our good wishes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, that's all we've got time for. Thank you very much for watching on a very special, big, big, historic election day in India. Thank you, Arun. Thank you, Shekhar. And a round of applause to Dorabso Pariwala for getting his exit poll right. And you don't know how right he got. He didn't mean BJP plus, he meant BJP.
No, let me say one thing
even
before
we end.
Right. No, the people think he and I have something to do with the exit poll. There are two or three other people. One, Namrata Gupta, who's worked with us for more than 20 years.
And another, we couldn't lady, do anything without
that's it. Right. Yeah. So one day Namrata phoned in early April to say, I'm ill, I won't be able to come today. And he said, how are we going to manage? Then she said, April Fool. So she, Iram Durrani, who's joined us in the last couple of years, there must be probably a few thousand tables we were looking at, and we don't know much about Excel. Without these two ladies, and they were assisted by Bijesh Babu, we could never have done this. We are in debt to them.
And of course, the Shok Das of Hamsa. Can I remind you of something, Dorab? When we were doing the four states battleground, I think you or Pranav mentioned that Namrata came up with a nugget that since 1952, the party that has ruled India has won Valsad in Gujarat and West Delhi.
Right. And by the way, it won it again today.
It won it again.
Bellwether constituencies.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
Thanks very much for watching. We've run out of time.
Nugget.
And thanks to all of you. And Arun, thank you very much for spending all this time with us. Bye-bye.